are the Org. Our mission is to assimilate Star Trek The Next Generation, Star Trek Deep Space Nine, and beer. Lots of beer.
Hello, friend!
Hello!
Welcome to bOrgCast 12.6. We have news! We have news! Ah, oh, it's a news rich, I would have thought, a few years ago when it didn't look like there was going to be any of a trek off in the occasional movie that we would have news to talk about, but there we are. Ethan Peck has been cast as Discovery's Spock.
Who's Ethan Peck?
I've no idea. IMDb'd him. He'd not been in anything I'd see, so I've got not a clue.
Some dude
who looks, well, not even vaguely like Leonard Nimoy, to be honest. They've just employed some dude by the looks of it.
Does some dude look a little bit like Zachary Quinto?
Not particularly, no.
Okay.
I don't. Presumably he acts like them, I can only think, because, yeah.
Some
in terms of looks, you know, Zachary Quinto and Leonard Nimoy
look
back
alive.
In the day,
yeah.
You could see that this guy, not so much. But anyway, he's promised that stories will still focus on the Discovery crew, though, so it's not going to be a backdoor Star Trek reboot, basically. Speaking of Star Trek reboots, we might not be seeing any new Trek films, because contract negotiations with Chris Hemsworth, who played Kirk's dad, and more seriously, Chris Pine, who, well, played Kirk, have broken down, apparently. And you can't really have a Star Trek film without Kirk. I mean, you don't need Chris Hemsworth, except for the fact I believe they've written the story that revolves around him, so
yeah.
That's a little awkward, but you could recast if needs be. But you can't recast the recast Kirk. I mean, that's just silly, isn't it? So maybe time to drop the reboot thing, possibly, maybe. Hey-ho, we shall see how that develops. But on to tonight's exciting episodes of Deep Space... What's gone wrong? Prodigal Daughter.
When Esri unravels a web of murder and deceit...
Any one of them could know, or all of them.
Will all roads lead back home?
I didn't kill her.
On the next Star Trek Deep Space Nine...
Yeah, that's a vaguely biblical title, although there's no real parallel here as the prodigal son returns a failure, whereas Esri is, well, she isn't a failure, she's just coming back to family, really, isn't she?
Yeah. Mm. Pretty much the best bit of the whole episode is the teaser.
Oh, I thought you were going to say when the final credits roll, sorry. The teaser, yeah, I suppose it promises much, doesn't it? That's possibly one of the problems.
Dax's guck that she ordered for Martok's birthday has arrived. Mm-hmm. She talks about the different types of gack and clearly feels ill. And you kind of think that maybe Martok's going to be in this episode. It's going to be his birthday party.
Oh, wow, yeah, we get to see Esri vomit. Woo! Which still would be preferable to what we saw in this episode.
Yeah, you know, or even if it was just Esri being awkward around Martok, but I was thinking you cling on piss up, this sounds good.
And who knew that gack was like Heinz 57 varieties?
Yeah,
I mean, you know.
Some of them have feet. Yeah, no, you get the whole gack monologue, you get the fact that Julian isn't saying very much and he's missing
his buddy, yeah.
So it turns out that the reason Miles is missing is not because of what he originally said, but he's actually gone looking for Bilby's widow.
A sequel to Honor Among Thieves, because that's what we were calling for. Not particularly, to be honest, but there we are. I do like the fact that Sisko goes talks about O'Brien being a one-man police force, which would have made a far more interesting episode than what we got here, let's face it. We're talking Robocop here, aren't we, basically?
And he's in New Sydney, which, even though it's got a name that's clearly human, isn't a Federation world.
Yeah, that's bizarre, isn't it?
Doesn't make any sense. Dax has got family there, so Sisko's like, can you see if your family can help? And Mum basically blackmails her, saying, no, you've got to come home in order for me to offer any help. And so Dax has to go and see her family. Oh, no, we're scared, or something. I don't know.
Yeah, she says, my family problems aren't as important as finding the chief, which is the basic problem with the episode.
Yeah.
It's all about her family problems.
Yeah.
Welcome to Deep Space Nine Does Dallas. Hergium, by the way, which is what they mine,
yeah,
features in the original series story Devil in the Dark, the big Horta blanket thing.
Oh, what, when
Spock mind melds
with a puke?
That's it. Yeah, it's okay. A pukey blanket.
Right.
Which is a far better episode than this.
So, my notes are not very many. Her brother is an artist, one of them.
Yes.
He's called Novovirus or something.
Novo. Yeah. He reminds me of a young Dick Van Dyke. He's got that look about his face. Particularly when he smiles.
Right.
Yeah.
He's an artist. He's been rejected by an art school. And it's clear that their mother has been putting him down. They find O'Brien because a police officer brings him in. Bilby's wife is dead. He's been beaten up only a bit by the police officer. Somehow that's okay. Cop seems a bit dodgy.
Just a bit.
Then her other brother, Janelle, which is a woman's name.
You have a woman's name, my lord.
Yes. Anyway, the other brother, Janelle.
Jane L. It's like it's the Superman character we never got to meet. Jane L.
So Janelle is the other brother. He's dealing with an equipment failure. Turns out to be sabotaged by the Orion Syndicate. And although O'Brien isn't there, he's like, that bloke's dodgy. That's like the Orion Syndicate. It sounds like you're under pressure from the Orion Syndicate. There's clearly a connection between Ezri's family and the Orion Syndicate. So they investigate and the quick look at the books, which Norvovirus has been dealing with, much to his own distress, shows that they were employing Marika Bilby, so the family is implicated. Who did it? Well,
we've got a choice of three, basically, haven't we? Wow, this is a great whodunit. Yeah. Bloody hell.
Janelle made the payments and she kept asking for more, but it was tortured, suicidal artist brother man who did it. So she was killed by Norvovirus. And then the mother's all upset and she says to Ezri, tell me I didn't do this. Ezri clearly blames her, but it can't just be her because plenty of people are raised by fucked up mothers and don't become murderers. I don't really give a flying fuck about this episode at all. I wish I hadn't watched it. The only thing I can say in favour of this episode is that because I was watching it, I drank a pint and a half of beer. It was nice beer.
Did you not like Ezri's purple t-shirt? I thought at least that would appeal to you.
It didn't look purple to me.
Oh, no.
It looked more sort of brown.
The highlight of the story is the map paintings. That's how bad this story is. Because we have some really nice map paintings of the Tegan family home. Tegan, not that Tegan.
I demand to see who's ever in charge of this shit.
Let us find out
well. Yeah. Nobody's got as much character as she has, let's face it, in this guy. It was apparently designed to reflect the designs of architect Frank Lloyd Wright.
So long, Frank Lloyd Wright.
Ooh, there's a tune! Yes. Yeah, that's the most interesting thing about this story. Did you recognise the sets at all?
Well, there's one bit of kit that keeps being reused.
Uh-huh.
And it was...
It's the drill thing that's malfunctioning.
Yeah, the drill head. It was full of something, and was it Quark hidden it?
Yes, in Who Mourns for Mourn.
Full
of latinum that wasn't actually latinum.
It was gold, wasn't it? It had the latinum removed because it was in his stomach, that's right. But it was also more vertically a prop used in that one where the bloke committed suicide.
You've lost me on that.
He was a scientist.
Oh, well, the one who flies himself into a sun or something.
Something like that, yeah. It was a prop in the cargo bay. Yeah,
I didn't recognise it.
In that episode. It looks a bit like an old-fashioned heater.
Okay, it looked more like just like a bin to me, to be honest, but there you go.
Heater, bin, don't care.
Let's call the whole thing off.
Yeah.
Did you recognise any of the sets?
Well, we were back in the cave, weren't we?
We were back in the cave at one point when they're doing the drilling, which I guess is logical.
Logical, you're drilling in a cave. Yeah. It makes more sense than drilling in the sky.
But the Tegan home, it's used in the previous episode. It's a redress affix. Both the bar and his... Norvo's room is basically, obviously, Vic's quarters when you think about it. It's even got the same shelving and stuff. It's like, oh man, you cheapskates.
No.
We're saving money here.
No, didn't recognise it, but there you go. Never mind.
Yeah.
Don't care. Can I have more beer?
Yeah, that I quite like O'Brien's line that Sisko's got a boot with his name on it. That's quite good. But yeah, I would have much rather seen a story revolving around O'Brien trying to solve the mystery rather than this Dallas Light episode where it's a murder mystery where there are only three people who could commit the murder.
Yeah.
And one of them is slightly disturbed. I wonder which one it's going to be.
Yeah.
The person who's murdered, we've never met.
Nope.
So we don't care.
Nope.
I mean, just because we met her husband doesn't mean to say we necessarily care about her, let's face it. We've only just met Esri's family, so we don't care about the fact that one of them is being banged up and the other two are mortified by it. But, I mean, we've literally only just met them, so why should we care?
Yeah.
That's just so many long, boring scenes.
Yeah, that's why I kept it to the short shit.
Yeah, it was a very last-minute script, which was originally...
Oh, what a surprise!
Yeah, funny that. Which was originally going to be a Sisko story that got dropped, and then was going to be about how the Syndicate arranged for Esri to become host to Dax, and then they realised that would mean the Syndicate had a lot of power over the Federation, which wouldn't be so good.
Yeah.
And it's so bad that Iris Stephenbear apologised to Nicola DeBoer for the weakness of the story, basically. Yeah. Oh man, your last season, and you do tripe like this? Really?
Yeah. Well, they were either writing a movie or focusing on Voyager at this point. They had too many plates.
Well, this writing stuff weren't. That's just it. But for some reason, they seem to want to do a lot of Dax stories because it's this new character. But I think that was a huge mistake because you've only got a few episodes to get to know before the season ends, and so.
But if they wanted to do a Dax story, they should have done something interesting that developed her character. We don't need to know about her fucking family.
We don't. I mean, again, as soon as the Next Generation was exactly the same, as soon as they start running out of ideas, they go, oh, let's investigate their family. I mean, practically every late season 7 story of Next Generation was something to do with family, and this one's different.
It's just bollocks.
Anyway, what does Sampo think? And it was all going so well. it had improved, hadn't it?
It had, yeah.
At least for a handful of episodes. So the episode begins with O'Brien being AWOL on the Mafia planet. This led me to falsely believe this is the annual torturing O'Brien episode. Mm-hmm. But no, it's getting to know Esri's family episode. You know the type, when the writers have written stories for one character for multiple seasons and start running out of ideas. Except that we've only known Esri for 10 episodes for now. It's quite hard to write feedback for this. The plot is okay. The characters are okay. The acting is okay. But I just don't care about anything that is happening.
No, you're not alone.
Esri is still so new, it's hard to care about her family. Yes. So I guess that's it. More or less a dud episode for me.
Yep.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Yep. And we've heard from the Mark, who writes, Prodigal Daughter, or wait, how does that even... This is a bland soap opera at best. Hang on. Is this the first company we see in the Federation? Well, no, because they're not in the Federation.
That's it. So the fact that they're earning Latinum and stuff, that's okay, because they're not part of the Federation. They sidestep that one nicely.
Yeah.
But then again, like you said, why is it called New Sydney?
That's what he says. New Sydney sounds like human.
Yeah, yeah.
It sounds like a Federation
company. And aren't the Trills part of the Federation, I thought?
Yeah, but if they move off world, they could have chosen to move
in
a non-Federation
place.
But yeah, if they wanted to make it somewhere that wasn't Federation, they should have come up with a better name than New Sydney, which sounds very human. And it says, the way Next Gen presented the Trill, they were new on the scene, and the Federation had barely heard of them. But DS9 has tried to insinuate that Curzon Dax actually was the key negotiator of the Kittimer cause and jointly famous and infamous. And that's a rather epic contradiction I never really thought of till now.
Yeah, you're right, actually, yeah.
Yeah. I found the Syndicate's methods interesting as an effective strong-arm without being overtly strong-armed. They're subtle but unmistakable about what they want and what they'll do to get it.
Well, the belly in it is the problem. I mean, it's...
He said, I still wish the Orion Syndicate would play a bigger part in the series when they play with this level quiet plot. And alas, the Syndicate plot is a means to an end here.
Mm.
And without it, immediately suspicion is going to fall onto the family members. Yeah, that's another thing. This was sort of, they could have potentially done something with the Orion Syndicate. Yeah.
Again, if we'd been following the adventures of O'Brien, kicking butts and getting names, that would have been interesting.
Yeah.
But that's not what this is about, ultimately. That, as he says, that's just what's in the background.
Yeah. He says, besides some of the story's circumstances strike me as a tad convenient. O'Brien disappears, fine. He disappears on Esri's home planet. Okay, an acceptable coincidence.
Well, it's not our home planet, but it's where our family currently are.
Yeah. He disappears while looking for someone who's vanished after having been given a job by Ezri's brothers.
Yeah, that's kind of coincidence. Yeah.
One who had eventually killed her. Now we're looking at a remarkably tiny universe.
Mm.
And our best, in inverted commas, counsellor sums up the plot like this. It's not my poor, sensitive brother's fault for beating a woman to death. Really, my mum, the castrating bitch, drove him to it. Yep, my theory is holding. Teenage me was thinking with his dick when it came to Ezri the first time round. Also, female ship's counsellor is revealed to have issues with her strong-willed mummy, was already done to death by TNG.
Yeah. What is it about these counsellors?
Yeah, and he says that Ezri is Diet Troy.
Ooh, that's very harsh, but... It's very hard to judge Ezri just on the basis that she only has a season. I mean, you can't compare her with Troy, who, you know, had seven seasons plus a few movies. It's completely unfair. I mean, she's not... By no means is she the most irritating thing about this episode.
No, but... The way she's written is irritating because a counsellor, she should fucking know that her brother also has to take responsibility for his own actions. That, yes, and their mother's a contributing factor, but...
Yeah, and it was chiming with me that whole thing about, you know, oh, my brother, he was so gifted and talented. That's what the people say about sports people that murder their partners and...
Yeah.
You know, but and that apparently makes it, you know, pitiable that they've killed somebody. What? I mean, no, they're the criminals. I'm sorry. Her brother is a criminal. I mean, she ought
to... But what about her own fucked up host? Wasn't he like a really talented musician?
More of that later, yeah.
Okay. Mm. Like you, he says, the map paintings are great.
Yes, saving grace.
Yeah.
Well, except they don't save the episode, but, you know, they keep you going at least.
Yeah. And he says, it isn't bad, and it would have been okay as a season one episode, but 6 years late to the party. But I like this compared to the next one.
All right. I'm the other way around, to be honest, but let's show me. Hand slightly. Did the Pie Man prefer this? Let's find out.
Hello, Orgs. Parry here, coming live from sunny Walsall. That's not actually sunny, but it's Walsall. To talk about Prodigal Daughter. The thing is with this one, I think this one, what gets me more about it is it's a missed opportunity. So I've got no objections to going to see Ezri's family. None at all. She does need a bit of fleshing out. Nice to see she has a family. It's also one of the things that has interested me for a bit is seeing life outside the Federation. You know, her family do not live within the Federation's rules. You know, the planet's independent. That's why they use money and they run a business. And indeed, it's kind of almost, for all that Trills are a Trill or a Federation species that people can live outside. I think it explains a lot more of what we saw in the original Brian one with the Orion Syndicate. That kind of makes sense. There's areas where humans and all species live that isn't within the Federation. Presumably it doesn't really belong to anyone. And that's where, obviously, you know, things fall through the cracks. You know, Starfleet doesn't have jurisdiction there, so they have to try and deal with local police and that sort of thing. All that's really interesting stuff, and it's rather a shame that what we get is the Ezri Dax family drama of the son who's an artist and the one who's not an overbearing mother, and it just seemed to be, and Ezri coming in and kind of mixing everything up and causing disruption and confusion and that sort of thing. When, in fact, there's a really interesting story about businesses outside the Federation being squeezed by the Orion Syndicate. I mean, you've got Dodgy Rongan, I can't remember his name, the sort of procurement or commodities trader, who wanders in. I was quite appreciative that everyone wore hard hats. Nice to see safety still alive and well in the future. But going in and saying, oh yes, you know, if you want fewer equipment failures, then you might just want to deal with the Orion Syndicate. And that was kind of interesting, whereas the actual plot with Bilby, so I was going to call him Bixby, but that's the Incredible Hulk, Bilby's wife being murdered by Dax's younger brother because she was extorting him due to... I thought what they had was some parts for something quite interesting, particularly considering that the Orion Syndicate have been seen to be working with the Dominion at times. And that could make for some very interesting plotting to find out that, you know, there is this sort of Dominion infiltration going on within the Orion Syndicate, sort of effectively working as cat's paws. But instead we get, like I say, this family drama. So I think it doesn't bug me so much that it stopped the plot. It's just that they could have worked the arc plot in with the basic ingredients of this and made something better. I don't know. I was trying to think of a cooking sort of analogy. It's kind of like having, you know, sausages, eggs, bacon, and not making a fry up, making some sort of strange sausage, egg, bacon pie, probably throwing kimchi into it or something, or you know, just something weird. Which, you know, you say, well, if you had all those bits, you could have made something really good or interesting. So yeah, it's not, like I said, I didn't find it bad per se. I mean, it didn't lose my interest, and I think if Edrey had been around, say, 3 seasons ago, and we did 3 seasons before of her family drama, we'd have been okay. But I think now we really want it to tie into the arc plot. And like I say, the Orion Syndicate was a great way to do it, and indeed something I'd love to see more of or hear more of, because it's an interesting idea of a criminal enterprise. But we didn't see any of that. Instead, it's kind of almost glossed over. You got obvious wrong, and I was like, oh, he's going to be interesting. And no, he's in that scene, and then he's gone. I was like, oh. And so, yeah, overall, that's what I think. You had a really good basis for an episode which kind of completely fell apart, which kind of disappointed me. So I'll be back shortly to talk about the Emperor's new cloak. Yay! Okay, until then, bye for now.
Yes. Yeah, I think it's rather like, I don't know about all having interesting ingredients, because as I say, all the interesting stuff is so way in the background that you don't really get to get excited about it. It's like walking into, it's so on Trek, it's like walking to McDonald's and ordering a salad, which I know you can do.
Yeah, Martin did it today.
Yeah, but why would you do it? I mean, my basic problem with this, it's a soap opera, it's not Star Trek. You could quite easily transpose this plot to any other medium in the world. It doesn't need to be Star Trek. It's just the sci-fi. It doesn't need to be sci-fi. I mean, it's just rubbish. Sorry.
I don't have an issue with the fact that it's not science fiction.
But it's Star Trek. It's supposed to be science fiction.
Yeah, but not every single episode of Star Trek is.
I mean, I would argue every single, you know, episode ought to be about starships. I know that that's just my particular blinking approach. But nevertheless, I can't help feeling that every single episode of Star Trek ought to be about science fiction.
Well, I think you can have episodes that are specifically about fleshing out and adding to a character. And that may have been the idea behind this episode, but it doesn't work.
Yeah.
It doesn't add anything to Ezri's character. We're not interested. We don't give a flying fuck about what's going on. But the idea you could potentially have an episode. What about that one with, I know it does use sci-fi concept, but the basic principle is, I think it's Dark Page, Star Trek Next Generation.
Yes.
And you find out that Troy has this sister that she never knew she had.
But the whole means by which it's revealed is a sci-fi thing, isn't it?
But the concept is very soap opera-y.
Yeah, I know, but at least it has a sci-fi element to it. That's what I'm saying. This has no sci-fi element.
No, it doesn't, but I think one of the reasons that Dark Page works for me is because it sheds new light on the relationship between two existing characters that at that point we know well, don't we? We know Luxana well.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
And we know Deanna well. So it works. But this was never going to work with a character we've only just met, mm-hmm. because there is nothing to flesh out between her and anybody else, because we've not met the anybody else's.
Yeah. I mean, and quite right, if we'd have had the Dominion connection again, if there'd been some sort of plan of the Dominion, that would have been good. That would have at least tied it into the rest of the season, rather than it sticking out like the proverbial sore thumb. And yeah, the hard hats. Okay, I'm glad you could get excited about the hard. They just look like ordinary hard hats. There was nothing. There wasn't even anything sci-fi about the hard hats. No blinking lights.
Yeah, but
no little aerials. Nothing. They just had hard hats with a logo on them.
Well,
they're not even trying at this point.
Yeah, but those hard hats are probably cheap as chips, and you're on a planet that's using money, and they're financially scraping by.
Well, I know, but they're future hard hats. Future hard hats, you know, it wouldn't take too much budget to have a couple of blinky lights, would it? Some built-in communicator?
I don't know. I really...
Just anything other than clearly what we currently use today. It just... Anyway.
Sorry, I'm sorry that the hard hats were insufficiently sci-fi. Science fiction.
Well, no, they're just emblematic of the entire episode being insufficiently sci-fi. Literally, the only sci-fi thing about this is the fact that they go on a spaceship to this planet, which you don't see anything of, particularly either, the journey. I mean, but I mean that's the only sci-fi element. This could literally be an episode of Dallas. It's pointless.
He's obsessed about the hard hats.
But yeah, I say they're just the tip of the iceberg.
Hard hats are wrong. Sorry about him. So, did Drew and Tracy think the hard hats are all wrong?
I bet they did.
So we've just watched Prodigal Daughter.
Yes.
And your thoughts on that one?
Well, when it first started, I thought, oh no, it's another Dex episode. Esri Dex episode. Yeah. I was like, oh god. But it turned into Murder, She Wrote the longer it went. I don't mind Murder, She Wrote.
Yeah. A little bit of Angela Lansbury, that's fine.
I was like, yeah, it was all right towards the end.
So her surname was Tegan.
Yeah.
Did we know that it was called? No. She was called Esri Tegan before.
Not that I recall. No.
Okay. I prefer Esri Dax.
Yes.
Yeah. So this was an episode that brought back the Orion Syndicate.
Yes, and Bilby.
Yeah,
Chester
which was,
the cat.
We actually really enjoyed that episode.
Yes, we
where,
did. Yes.
Chester was in it, and Bilbo was killed.
Bilby. Yes. Yeah.
And this kind of brought it back. Bit sinister.
Yeah, I know. One of the things I liked about this was non-Federation world.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, like far out on the spiral rim, you might even say.
Oh, hello.
And it was interesting, you know, where the Federation isn't, like, around and everything's perfect. It's like, it's interesting to see the other side of it where things aren't all, like, you know, green grass and all that, like, isn't it?
Yeah, so maybe it's just me, and I'm not sure if you'll go, oh yeah, of course it is, but did they actually explain what family business was?
It's some kind of mining,
yeah,
isn't
so
it?
Yeah, some kind of miners.
Don't know.
Okay, it did that, yeah, that just seemed a bit boring.
Yeah. You knew that brother...
Norvo.
No, Janelle was going to be involved in it, didn't you? Because he had kind of like a... kind of side-eye look to him, didn't they? You always know the baddies in Star Trek, they've got a side-eye,
I just think
they?
They've got a look of complete stress about them.
Yeah,
know?
Yeah.
Yeah, you knew that they...
And we didn't know the younger brother was going to be involved. That was,
that was
the
Murder,
She
Wrote
twist. Yeah, yeah, definitely, yeah.
But, yeah, when they're in the teaser bit at the beginning, and I mentioned the Orion Syndicate, you said, oh, they're going to have something to do with this. And it was just a bit...
Bloody ice cream man again!
No, thank you very much. But yeah, it was just how it kind of evolved. I didn't buy the fact that she was their mother for a second because she's about 10 years older than
Janelle. I know, yes. She obviously had a lot of plastic surgery or whatever. The overbearing mother, yeah. No, it's cut to the chase because I don't think Eva's got too much to say about this, have we? It was all right. It was all right episode.
Yeah, it was okay. I'm not quite sure... you know, this silly, like, I hate these episodes where it kind of features on two characters, but then every other character that is, like, salaried in Deep Space Nine has to have, like, an appearance, like, so what was, like...
You're always saying
because it annoys me, because it doesn't add anything to the story, you know. All right, so Bashir had a bit of a background because he kind of, you know, was covering for the chief.
You don't have to go through it.
But it was just, what the fuck are Kira and Odo doing? You know, it's just, it really pisses me off.
No, Peter did say, he said that they're getting the wages, so they might as well include him in the episode. You're thinking, oh, they're in it, so they get paid. Peter's saying they get paid, so let's get them in the studio.
Yeah, but it's just, if it's adding nothing, then it's just bollocks, isn't it?
Fair enough.
A swim or whatever. But yeah, this was okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
Not bad.
It was all right. It was a bit of a...
Six out of ten.
We knew that what the ending was going to be.
Well, I didn't know what an episode was going to be, like the younger brother.
You said...
That, that was like about... 15 seconds before he said it, wasn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, this is right.
It's all right.
Kind of, again, liking Esri.
Yeah, yeah. More character development, I guess. Leave it out.
Aye.
Okay.
Let's have another one.
Yep.
See you later.
Bye.
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 I'm glad you found it interesting. That was the one thing I didn't find it.
No, it's too long since I've watched Murder, She Wrote. I can't remember if the...
I bet there were more than three suspects in an episode of Murder Than She Wrote generally, because otherwise that would be pretty pointless to watch as well. I mean, that's the basic problem, is it can only be one of three people. Well, what's the point in watching this bloody thing then? I'm not surprised you guessed who it was, because you got a one in three chance.
Yeah.
And it wasn't going to be Mr. Side-Eye, because that was too obvious, so he immediately discounted. So it was Madwoman or Crazy Son. I mean, it's going to be Crazy Son, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And I don't want Murder, She Wrote. I want bloody Star Trek. Yeah. That's the basic problem here.
Yeah.
Well, did the God of Llamas, who has recently been on a very exciting-looking Transformers convention, I believe he sent his feedback before he went on that, but there's been some exciting pictures on Twitter, it has to be said.
And as long as pictures of llamas.
And including pictures of llamas, yes. Did he enjoy this episode of Murder, She Wrote? I mean, Star Trek.
Llama God's Log, Scotty, Ok Jake, Ok Fikert. There seems to be trouble down to bit. If only it was that. If only it was that. Instead, it's not. Alas, here we go. Show my hand. A little bit early, but it's a hand that's been withered slightly from having watched two mediocre episodes of Deep Space Nine. Yeah, stop listening now. So we have an Esri backstory family. Hurrah! Which, again, as we've said before, is kind of necessary. We still need to get to know our character, but we're close to being halfway through the season now. We need to stop exploring and start concluding. So it's unfortunate she gets to draw the short straw by being the last one through the door, but we really don't have time for this. But the writers seem to think we did. So hey, there we go, and here we are. And it's unfortunate because this episode starts off promisingly enough, and it is nice to see how repulsed Esri is with Klingon food. I mean, it makes a nice change and does really highlight the fact that this is a different person now. Right. Different set of taste buds. It's a shame, really, that we didn't have a scene where she eventually discovered she likes fish fingers and custard, but that's a whole other thing. And yeah, it's interesting because Bashir is missing his boyfriend, and it's exciting when it turns out the Miles is indeed arriving. Or is it O'Brien that he's missing, because when he leaves to go to beat the ship that's docking, Odo does say to him, "Give my regards to Santana." Does Bashir maybe have a secret black magic woman? And it seems like this is going to be the annual Miles torturing episode, and unfortunately, never thought I'd say this, it's not, because they've kind of run the two plots together. O'Brien happens to be on the same outpost that Esri's family works in, and so Esri goes to look for him, and their plots kind of turn up together, neither of them being particularly satisfying in the end. It turns out that O'Brien has been hunting for Bilby's widow, who unfortunately turns out to have died, so that adds a little bit of a sad postscript to last year's episode. And unfortunately, it's not really dwelt on very much, because we spend most of the time focusing on Esri. We don't really focus on the consequences of O'Brien's mission, the part he had to play in that, because that would have been interesting to see. But instead we get a slightly mediocre family drama. And I mean, I think probably the most interesting thing about this is that, yeah, while they have set up a mine in the cave set, it does beg the question, and maybe it was covered in the episode and I just wasn't interested enough to pay attention, but what society do they actually live in? Because they're being paid how, what money, who, what are they doing with Latinum? Why do they need Latinum? I mean, presumably this is why Esri wasn't ever in line to be a trial host, because clearly her family aren't part of Federation society at all, but then she was part of Starfleet, so this is very bizarre. They're living in a future Federation that has no money, except they seem to be earning money and worried about money and the Orion Syndicate and stuff. And it's a shame, because there were hints of a better story in there somewhere. And it's kind of an interesting twist that it's the artistic little brother who's the tortured artist who turns out to be the one that was the murderer in the end. But on the other hand, it's kind of slightly too obvious to be signposted. And given that we have no time to get to know them, it's hard to mourn the character. Again, there's a problem with the 45-minute episode format. But it just doesn't quite have the impact, especially when the investigation comes to an end when Norvo just kind of gives himself up. There's not a lot there to recommend it, really. I can't really say very much about it. The story all ends with Esri's mother ending, whether it was all her fault, and well, yeah, it was, but I can't find it myself to care. The thing I liked most about the episode was the lovely map painting they did for the planet surface, because, well, the interactive map painting, because it was kind of okay when you saw it in daytime, and then, oh, there's a nighttime version as well. They figured out how to swap the palette in Photoshop, so yay. I mean, that's at least a little aesthetic improvement, but that's probably the best thing I have to say about the episode, so it's pretty forgettable. A competent season one episode, but it's kind of not where we're after this point, so anyway, what could possibly be worse than this?
Let's hear it for map painting fans.
Yeah, it is map paintings for the win.
It's got some of us through this episode, I think. And you're quite right, there's no time to get to know these families, so you don't care about them by the end.
No, that's just it, you don't, because you don't know them.
They're outside the Federation, she makes the point, and she actually sort of runs away to the Federation from her family to get away from them, so that's kind of the reason why they're dealing with money and stuff. So they do cover their asses on that front. But yeah, O'Brien's story and doing the investigating stuff would have been far more interesting.
Absolutely.
Than what we ended up with.
Absolutely.
Oh, and the Santorana, I don't know if you were joking about that, but in case you weren't, that was an Alamo reference. There we go. Yeah. Unimpressed, as were most of us.
Yes. I thought it was a pile of wank.
It was boring. That was, even if something is bad, if it's, you know, at least got you agitated and interested, that's something. But this is just boring. It's major sin. It's not sci-fi. That's even more major sin. Okay, that's the worst thing.
That for you?
Yes. Well, I'm not sure. I'm not just me, I'm sure.
No, but
not many people tune into Star Trek to see Dallas or Murder, She Wrote.
But if it had been a good episode, but happened not to be particularly science fiction, you might have gone, well, that was a bit old.
Well,
but I enjoyed it.
I don't know. I can't think of a good episode of Star Trek that wasn't science fiction to some degree.
Well, what about the what's-his-face... oh, Dick Bollock thing.
God, where's this going? Oh my God. This is a whole porn film I never saw.
No. Oh, I suppose it's got science fiction in it, but it's the shitty science fiction I wish wasn't there.
What?
Holodeck, Dick, what's-his-face, and Picard.
Oh, yeah, well, the whole point is that they're investigating what it means to be on a holodeck and an artificial environment and all that. Yes, it's not Dick Tracy, it's Dick... Oh, no, yeah, I'm stuck on the dick as well now. Oh, dear. Ow! Well, that's going to annoy me. It has been a little while since we covered these episodes, to be fair.
You know what I mean, though?
I do now, but they were sci-fi because the whole setup of it wasn't the fact that it was, you know, a noir thing. It was the fact that it was an artificial noir thing and you were investigating the implications of that. That was sci-fi.
Yeah, but for me, the fact that it was sci-fi was irrelevant and I didn't like it.
No, that was the whole point of it for me.
Fight for you. What I'm saying is there are other...
was his name?
I don't know.
God's character.
I don't know.
Oh, and all I want to say is Dick Tracy. It wasn't Dick Tracy.
No. And it wasn't Dick Gently either.
That's Dirk Gently. I don't even know how to find this out by wikiing it. That's the awful thing.
I don't know. Oh, just, no, don't wiki. Just go on to Google.
So I've put Picard Dick in now. That's just a bad idea, isn't it? No, I don't want to be Googling that.
No! No! Try something like...
Dicks! Dixon Hill! Ah! Thank God I didn't have to wiki that.
Oh, dear.
Lordy. Okay, let's move on to the next exciting...
Let's do that.
...episode.
The Emperor's New Cloak.
Yes.
Or cock. About being naked.
Yes.
The Ferengi leader is held hostage.
This is an alternate universe. Shouldn't everything be different?
Oh. But in this reality, it's hard to know who your friends are.
Uh-oh.
On the next Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
Which is a trailer that makes it sound kind of interesting.
Yeah, it's not though, is it?
Not massively, no. I mean, the interesting feature is that having watched Prodigal Daughter beforehand, it seemed marginally better than that, so I enjoyed it a lot more as a result, whereas we'd actually watched it a couple of years ago, a year or so ago.
Yeah.
Doing some research, I think, was it for...
Space Doc.
Space Doc Fury,
because I brought
a
ship.
You brought the massive Nagavar, yes, to get score on size.
Yes.
I don't know. But, yeah, so we watched it for research for that, and it was like, oh, this is terrible, man. But, yeah, compared to Prodigal Daughter... Not so much, in my view, but clearly not everybody shares that view. Anyways, it has a dedication to Jerome Bixby, who is the...
not Bilby and not Bilbo.
No, who's the writer of Mirror Mirror, who'd recently died, so that's kind of nice. Good start. Well, obviously not him dying, but in terms of, you know, paying homage to him creating this whole mirror universe that, let's face it, Deep Space Nine makes an awful lot of. Some would argue... too much of, and this is definitely the point where the camel's back is not so much broken as somebody drops a nuke on it, basically.
Yeah.
The Grand Nagus has disappeared, because it's not just a mirror episode, it's a Ferengi comedy episode as well. Nice. Yay. One. Quark is more worried about Ezri and Bashir getting close together. But then we see Quark in prayer, which is nice. This is like, we've never seen this before, blimey. And it's really cleverly shot, the way it tracks around him. It's LeFar Burton who directed this, and he does a good job of the direction. No complaints there. It's slightly let down by the fact that Quark's idol thing is basically one of those money banks I had as a kid. Bank. Yeah, that you put money in it and it, something would happen. I remember there's one where a hand grabbed you when you put the money in it. Do you remember that?
Freak the shit out.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that was the whole point of it. It was just like a Frankenstein money bank thing. Yeah, money banks back in the day used to do things. They were exciting back in the days when we encouraged kids to save money rather than just splurge it immediately on the internet.
I just had a Henry's Cat one.
Did you? What did the Henry Cat do?
It was just a Henry's Cat one.
Oh, that's pretty boring, though. Oh, well, never mind. No, I'm talking about actual action. I mean, there was one that you put money in and it gave you chocolates. I remember that as well. It was like a little chocolate
shop. I
just
smashed the fucker to get the chocolates.
Yes, that was probably the downside of that design. But anyway, I wonder what happens to the money Quark puts in as well. Because, I mean, that's not just going to disappear into the ether, is it? So what, he takes it like I used to do with my money bank? You just take it out the back and put it back in again to watch the action?
Oh, like the chocolate biscuit machine in
That's it.
The marvellous mechanical mouse mill.
Hey, look. A chocolate biscuit.
Oh, wow. That takes me back. Bagpuss. Check it out, kids. Quality television. Anyway, it's better than this. He asks the Blessed Exchequer for aid to enable him to get together with Esri, and she turns up. Oh! Except this is Mirror Esri, and she's all levers and moodiness and pointy daggers and stuff. Deboa enjoyed playing a very different Esri. Glad she was having fun. Quark thinks she's role-playing T'Lana from Vulcan Love Slave, which is a nice reference.
Oh, you can call me Shmun!
Yes.
Shmun?
She's actually delivering a message from Zek, who's being held captive by the Alliance. Oh, yes. They want a cloaking device, which Zek says they don't have. But they had loads of cloak ships in Through the Looking Glass. So, wow, that's continuity fail.
So, hang on, which one is Through the Looking Glass?
Oh, what season? It's not the first one, it's the second one, I think. Yes.
I don't remember that.
But, yes, they did have cloak ships, so apparently they've forgotten how to cloak their ships or something. Anyway, Quark and Nog steal a cloaking device from Martok's Bird of Prey, and it's somehow activated, despite the fact it's clearly not plugged in. And we were told before that, you know, cloaking devices needed a lot of power. So how's this working exactly? But never mind, it's obviously just played for laughs, isn't it? Grundachik and Shimmerman practiced carrying the cloak for 3 days, apparently. That's dedication.
Oh, now you've earwormed me with that Roy Castle tune from Record Breakers.
Dedication. That's what you need if you want to be the best. And if you want to be the rest, dedication's what you need.
Yeah, that was a show. Anyway, let's not dwell on
Sorry.
That. The dodgy days of the 70s. On the run from Martok, they join Esri on Terek Nor, and we meet Mira Vik, who isn't a hologram, which doesn't make any sense.
No, but this episode doesn't make any fucking
sense. No, and that was kind of the point Bear was making. He was supposed to be exposing the ludicrousness of the Mira setup, which I can't help feeling exposing the ludicrousness of your show isn't a good plan, really. Never mind. Anyway, Vic is shot by Bashir, so that was worth doing, wasn't it? That's literally, yeah, what characters haven't we used yet? Oh, we haven't used Vic. Let's use him.
Yeah.
Held captive by the rebels, Esri suggests a smart move for Quark and Rom would be for them to go back to their universe. Do we look smart to you? Quark amusingly asks. Mira Brunt turns up to rescue them with a Ferengi shuttle, and they rendezvous with the Regent. The Intendant turns up and snogs Dax, and it becomes clear the Ferengi won't be getting the Nagus back and get locked up with him instead. For reasons. I mean, they may as well just have killed them at this point, but it turns out it's just as well they didn't, but it doesn't make any sense. The Intendant kills Brunt, ensuring there's a Ferengi getting offed in every Mirror story. Hey-ho. Esri suggests they get Rom to install the cloaking device. Once Rom is finished, of course, they're scheduled to die at the hands of Garak, who's having way too much fun. Although Andrew Robinson wasn't. He wasn't too keen on the one-dimensional evil Trom that he was playing.
Yeah, he's not. And also, the only other thing I would say is Garak is the only one who makes any sense in this episode because he repeatedly says, we should kill these people.
Yes.
And in that, he's right in that context. That's baddies. Yeah. That's what they should be doing.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, lock them up for no reason. Yeah. Anyway, the Kardashian threatens his prisoners with 10cc.
It's just a silly phase I'm going through.
The Ferengi tease him for not being as ruthless as the real Garak, which is, to be honest, just a bit naff, but there we are.
It just makes you want the real Garak.
It does, doesn't it? Yeah, and I think Andrew Robinson felt the same.
Yeah.
The Regent attempts to attack the Defiant, but all the lights go out thanks to sabotage by Rom, and he takes it out in his chair, because... Yeah. He's pathetic.
That's why Worf got this Worf got such a low score.
Yeah, yeah, there's a captain's. Yes.
Yeah.
In the confusion, Ezri kills Garak and rescues the Ferengi. The Defiant attacks in what I suspect are reused effect shots from Shattered Mirror, and the Regent has to surrender, taking it out on his chair again, because that's his thing, apparently. Back on Tarak Nor, they say goodbye to Ezri, with Quark hoping to spend some more time with her, but she's only interested in Miralita. For laughs. Yeah.
Yeah,
it's all very silly. Let's face it. I mean, it's not boring, at least, but it's not all that good. Yeah, I mean, it flies fast and loose with Trek, so it's hard to care about what's happening. And it's worse when you're trying to evaluate the Nagvar for space dock. It has to be said, but
yeah,
it's just like two not very good episodes of Star Trek in a row.
Well, I mean, at least this one is, as from your point of view, has spaceships.
It does. Yes, it has space battles.
And you get to
well
see
realized,
the enormous Nagvar, gonna take you to a Nagvar.
But, yeah, they had drained the well dry for Mirror Universe stories, at least one Mirror Universe story ago, if
and
not more.
And Ferengi comedy ones.
And indeed
and this is both. It's terrible.
It's doubling down badly.
For me, this is worse than the Ezri one.
Yeah.
Because the Ezri one is just meh. I don't like it, but for me it's nothing to get angry about.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas this, you've got Quark and Rom back to being complete idiots, and they've grown as characters.
Well, Quark not so, because he knows full well that they're being played. Max Grundychik is a complete idiot in this, but then again, yeah, that's generally Rom, isn't it?
Yeah, but, you know, and it's... And they play... with the cloaking device.
Oh, don't.
Which weighs a ton so they can carry it, and then it's smaller, and on some kind of fucking stretcher with some kind of knitted blanket on it, or whatever the fuck, when they go and bring it into the Nagvar.
Yeah, that doesn't seem particularly consistent.
And
yeah.
Mirror Worf is shit.
Yeah, he's just pathetic, isn't he?
And Mirror Garak is not a patch on proper Garak.
No.
You just want proper Garak and proper Worf.
Yeah.
And just...
Not this, really.
And I don't like mirror universes as a rule anyway.
Well, the previous ones, as you may remember, I always took something away from them I enjoyed. This one, no.
No.
I'm sorry, it's just enough already.
No, I just get cross, I don't give a flying fuck, and it's another Ferengi comedy thing, which I don't like.
Most of those I enjoyed. I think the previous one I hadn't enjoyed so much. This one... Again, no. Just no.
Some of the Ferengi comedy ones have made me laugh.
Yeah, yeah,
one,
some of them have been good, but not this.
But this one isn't, and it's just terrible.
Mm.
And it's just... I'm just sitting there going, you know, whereas the Ezri one, I was just like, meh. This is making me cross. I don't like it.
No. It's not good.
No. And we've heard from Wayne. He writes, Star Trek Night, and it's DS9's Emperor's new cloak. Oh, God, it's a Mirror Universe story. Still, it's also a Ferengi comedy episode, so we can kind of ignore it. On a plus note, though, sexy rocks chick Ezri, wing ding. Well, thank fuck that's over.
Yeah, this was two tweets, by the way. So, initially, he's like, ooh, sexy Ezri, that'll get me through. No.
Someone please tell me that's the last of the Mirror Universe episodes. Oh, and the last of the Ferengi comedy episodes too.
Good news, everybody.
Yes.
It is. Yeah, I mean, I suppose you could kind of see they wanted to do one more in the last season just because they, you know, they'd done them in previous seasons, but we really rather wish they hadn't. But never mind. The Mark has this to say, the Emperor's new cloak, or how could this go so utterly wrong? Before I open fire... Quark and Rom carrying the cloaked cloak is a magnificent bit of physical comedy that requires two actors in perfect sync. That out of the way, on with the murder. Yeah, I'm afraid even that didn't amuse me in the slightest. No. I think it might have done the first time I watched it, but not now. I'm really beginning to hate this universe. Yeah. Let's do bare maths. Ferengi plus mirror universe plus lesbians equals everything the viewers could ever want. I have a question. Was this written by a couple of not-too-bright 13-year-old boys? I ask as the entire plot is predicated on writers Ira Baer and Hans Bimler forgetting that the Alliance was established as having cloaking technology back in Through the Looking Glass. Yep. If only the showrunner had been able to check them. Oh wait, Baer is the fucking showrunner. It's also depressingly dull and predictable. We know Worf is going to rant and rave. We know the Intendant is going to flirt with everyone and slink to an unconvincing last-minute escape. We know that a Ferengi's going to get killed this time. This time, it's Nice Guy Brunt. Yeah. And the whole Intendant escaping, what was the point of that when we know there's not going to be any more of these? Hey-ho.
Oh, I don't, because that's what the Intendant does.
Then we have the bit that breaks my brain, making Vic Fontaine real for a cheap gag. I know, that makes no sense!
Yeah.
Yeah, the various points where Rom says this makes no sense. This really does make no sense.
Yeah.
Disappointing only begins to describe the Emperor's new cloak. Words like a waste, meaningless, and boring also come to mind.
Yep. Yeah.
Everything that happens in this episode was born out of an attitude that seems to say we have a Ferengi and evil characters who need a story. Simply put, very little in this plot is worthy of attention. The characterizations are aimless and confused. Everybody's appearance comes off as gratuitous, and no one gets any worthwhile dialogue. It's true, there are no zingers in this, are there, really?
No.
To say everyone in the episode is poorly motivated would be an understatement. Character reactions border on random, thanks to the confines of a shoestring plot. Just think of all the opportunities for scheming and payback, especially given the volatile nature of the Kira Garrick Worf alliance. All are put aside for bad comedy. I realise the Mirror Universe has been shallow ever since Through the Looking Glass, but it always had a certain madcap appeal, but this is dire. We come to the biggest failing of the not-too-bright 13-year-old boys. You know this was coming. The Ezri-Kira relationship. Ezri and Kira have apparently been lovers, but the relationship is so sketchy and undefined. Of course, the relationship probably wasn't meant to be taken seriously. It all but shouts, "Look how hip we are! We have lesbians! Lesbians are cool!" That motivation would be bad enough in it of itself. No, they're that way because it's hot! Why else but to be for base titillation appealing to the stereotypical horny, puerile, basement-dwelling, convention-attending demographic? While the Intendant's narcissism and sexuality were particularly interesting in their outlets in previous Mirror Universe shows, particularly Crossover, here it's half-baked and fetishized. Fetishized. I struggle with that word, funny enough. What's worse is the pointless debriefing walk-on of Mirror Leader at the end. Which is played for a cheap laugh that again buys into that. You've used the word again, you bastard. F-word. Lesbians, yay! Playboy TV mindset. Wow, thanks for the insult to homosexuals and bisexuals everywhere. This just felt like a step backward and a cheap step backward done for ratings.
Yeah.
So how could things go so utterly wrong? I think the writers were too busy in the back having a wank over fantasies of Nicola de Boer and Anna Visitor having sex to do a decent job on the script. Okay, harsh, but mostly fair,
yeah,
I think it's fair to say.
I'm not sure it's unfair at all.
Yeah, it is sad.
Yeah. What did Sampo make of this one? He writes, "The Mirror Universe stories have been getting steadily worse and now we've hit rock bottom."
Mm.
I mean, the whole Mirror Universe is a joke at this point.
Yeah, literally.
The writers know this is the last time they're visiting this universe and they're cramming in all the characters we haven't seen there yet, including Vic Fontaine in a bizarre twist. I was half expecting him to be a hologram like the EMH until he was shot. I do admit seeing Brunt be a good guy got a smile out of me, but otherwise this was utter shit.
Bobbins!
Hoping for a better pair of episodes next week.
Oh, please.
It can't be any worse.
We'll come to those. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Who we got next?
It's Mr. Llama the God.
Llama God's Log Supplemental. I am wearing eyeliner and I have grown a goatee just for this feedback, although that's kind of pointless because you can't see this. And I've got a beard anyway, so that doesn't really highlight the kind of Mirror Universe look I was going for. Oh well. So the episode starts with looking like maybe Dax and Bashir coming of things, so that if this does happen, that'll be interesting. I mean, Dax was pretty mean to Bashir in her first episode, on the station, when, you know, she tells him that it would have been him and Jadzia, but never mind. Which, as everyone said, was, you know, a little bit cruel, exploitative, and just unfair, so yeah. No never mind. I guess Bashir forgives a pretty face easily. And Quark remains being jealous because Quark is Quark is Quark. Probably the best part of the episode for me was seeing Quark pray, and they do have a shrine, and that's kind of both hilarious and also interesting, you know, based upon how the culture is actually depicted, that this is how they pray. My big question is, where does the money go? I mean, it's, again, hilarious that they put it in through a slot in the ear, because obviously ears are a powerful organ for the Ferengi, but where does the money go? Who collects it? I want to know more about this, actually. In fact, I'd like to see an episode dealing with that, as opposed to what we do get, which is the Negus has gone missing again, of course, because reasons, and the instance that Goth Ezri turned up is like, oh, fuck, it's a Ferengi comedy episode and a Mirror Universe episode. It's the worst of both worlds. Please, someone, give me a massive blast and deflect a dish, please, before it's too late. Air's too late, though. The main plot, I'll say it now. Air. I'm really not fussed. It's a bit of backs and forwards, backstabbing. Worf as the regent, Kira as the intendant. It's all overplayed and tired by now, and given what's actually happening in the real universe, we really didn't care. I mean, maybe someone on the writing staff decided they really wanted to tie up all the loose ends in this and resolve the Mirror Universe story that they'd set up in previous episodes before finishing the actual proper story. But yeah, this was not the way to do it. This was very anticlimactic. Finishing with a shot of the Defiant standing off against a Klingon super battlecruiser just because Ron manages to sabotage the cloak. Worf giving in very easily, and Bashir threatening to board the ship. I mean, come on, how many people could the fucking Defiant actually hold? There must be thousands of fully armed and fully trained Klingons and Cardassian soldiers on that ship. The moment they get boarded, they'd all be killed. There's no bloody point. But no, we have to have a victory because that's the kind of episode they want to do. Yeah, I don't know, this was just really, really weak. I mean, okay, I guess a couple of things that may have been quite good. Well, sorry, that's giving me way too much praise. That may have been vaguely interesting. The fact that Zek actually went over there to try and money-making opportunities. Yeah, that's actually quite interesting. The fact he goes himself, I mean, considering how he opened negotiations with the Dominion, that's not... Yeah, you'd have thought he'd been a bit more careful about it. Armin Shimonen and Max Grodinchik do some good physical comedy with the cloaking device, so, I mean, that's kind of amusing to watch. And discovering that Vic is actually a real person in that universe, I mean, that was also great. But they kill him too soon, because that would have been an interesting idea, so never mind. Unfortunately, we also get the same tropes, you know, that we've learned that the Intendant and Ezri are a thing, because of course they are, because they're both bad girls, and all lesbians are bad girls. And likewise, at the end of the episode, it seems that Leeta is picking up Ezri instead, with a very, very bad Bond-esque one-liner. And again, it's because people can only be basically anything that's even the slightest bit deviant, as a lot of conservative people would put it. They can only have those sorts of relationships in a mirror universe, where it's not the real world, so that's okay, because real people aren't non-heterosexual. Yeah. Well done, way for being progressive there, Star Trek. So, ultimately, yeah, this is a pathetic conclusion to the movie universe. I mean, I enjoyed the first couple of episodes. Now it's really tired. The bad guys aren't the bad guys. They're just comedy of the worst kind. And yeah, got nothing else to say really. But here we are. We are now halfway through the season. Let's hope the final half and bring things on the boil and get up to a proper head of steam until we find out whether they can or not. Glory to you and your cast.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, seeing Quark pray was the best bit of the episode for me.
Yeah.
Sadly, that was right near the beginning, so... And where does the money go?
Where does it go? Good point
about the boarding, though.
Yeah.
They should have just destroyed the ship.
They should have done.
Because it had no power. They didn't stand a chance if they boarded it, so they should have just blown it up. But they didn't, because... They seem to be working on the basis there's going to be another Mirror Universe story. That's a bit weird, isn't it? Because not only does the Intendant escape, but they only capture Worf.
Yeah.
Rather than kill him. It just makes no sense. And when they bring him on, it's just him as well. Where's everybody else on that ship? Oh.
And also as well, like, if you think about the numbers of crew, you could think that maybe the reason that Worf goes, yes, victory is yours, come and board me...
Yeah, well, if
it's
he said
because
that.
He's going to say that to get them on, and then he's going to kill them all.
Yeah,
and
but he doesn't.
He's going to have two ships.
Yeah.
But that's not what happens.
Yeah.
Makes no sense.
And yes, the sexual politics are appalling, aren't they?
Yeah.
At least we've got Discovery now to try to make up for that.
Yes.
Yes.
What about Drew and Tracy? Did they like this one?
This is our feedback for The Emperor's New Cloak.
And what did you think of that one then?
Rubbish.
Yeah, when it first started up and we knew it was a Ferengi episode, we was like a bit like, oh.
And then when it was a Mirror Ferengi episode, that was just like double
worse.
Rubbish, yeah.
Fucking Ezri is like the Mirror. Not too bad, but I really hate Kira as her Mirror.
The Intendant.
Yeah, is that her name, the Intendant?
It is, yeah.
Why do everyone, like all the women in the Mirror universe have to wear like makeup?
I don't know.
What? I don't get it.
Like heavy makeup.
Yeah.
They're just so they look different, isn't it? Just so different looks.
So the Negus asks for his ear hair to be
tugged
with.
Or whatever, yeah.
That's just nasty. If you ever said something like that to me, that'd be just grounds for divorce.
You're tugging my ear.
That's nasty.
It's never going to happen.
No. Why would they write something like that into an episode? That's just... Bashir looked like a tramp in this episode.
Well, he's like space pirate Bashir, isn't he?
He's still like a tramp. You know, the girls are quite sassy.
Yeah.
And the blokes are just like trampos.
They do.
They could have been a bit more suave.
Yep.
I think. And why did we not see Cisco in this mirror?
He was working for the mirror people, wasn't he, before? It's difficult to remember who's alive, who's dead. I think he's still alive.
So again, this is an episode where everyone gets their token 5 minutes. So Odo's in the bar, Cisco's walking around with Martok, just being silly, and like the rest of them are in the mirror.
Yes.
It's just stupid.
I'm really hoping that this is the last ever mirror episode of DS9 now, because I think this was episode 12, so it can't be any left.
Why?
Surely.
Why?
Well, because they're coming up to the final episodes, aren't they?
Yeah, but surely they're not going to have 12 final episodes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There's a lot that can be done in these, episodes.
Now, I'm hoping that there's no more mirror now. Let's fingers crossed it, eh?
Why does she have to be a lesbian as well?
They're all, weird sexuality over there, aren't they?
So that means all the men are gay, then?
This is the thing. No, they're not, are they? You don't see that in the men.
The intendant have to be a lesbian?
I don't know.
Why does Esme have to be...
I don't know.
...that way inclined?
It's just titillation, isn't it, really?
Yeah. For the male writer or the male viewer.
That's what I tend to think.
Yeah. I did say to you, when they had the kiss, I bet when this was shown in pages, everyone was like,
I can only imagine it, yes.
Romulan hours on the house. Yeah.
Anyway, should we end it there?
Yeah, this is boring.
Yeah, I don't know if it's boring. It's just no interest in a Ferengi mirror episode.
Yeah, that's why it's boring. It just had no interest for me.
Nope.
And then at the end when Lita comes out and she looks at Rom like, you're a piece of shit. That's just nasty.
Yep.
Don't have to do that, do you?
No.
Anyway, leave it there.
Okay.
Next one, please, and hope it's better.
Yes, definitely.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Yeah, it's double rubbish. You're quite right.
It is. And yeah, the ear tug, that is nasty, the ear hair tug.
Yeah, that is yes, that's our sexual tip for tonight. Do not tug on the ear hairs.
No. Oh, that's just wrong. I agree, that is bad. And yeah, it is just all about titillation, the whole thing with... Because it's not that everybody's gay. It's not that the alternative universe is gay. It's just the women. Because...
Sexy times. Well,
In terms of what Bashir is like, he does look dishevelled and crap because they're all...
Okay.
Sorry. I was just trying to make something of this episode, even if it was just a tune.
Well, let's find out what Pie Man made of this episode.
Hello again, Pari here to talk about the Emperor's new cloak. So, ideas you thought had been worn out at the very, very end in Deep Space Nine. The Mirror Universe. And bear in mind, I'm someone who liked the Mirror Universe a lot longer than the episode really deserved it. And the Ferengi, and I'm one who's never bothered with the Ferengi episodes and could usually find something good in them, except for that one where Quark becomes a woman. That was just all kinds of awful. But no, both ideas had finished. You know, we've wrung every last plot out of them. Oh, no, we've not. No, we'll merge them together. Now, the only thought I had as why this even came in is that someone higher up was going, oh, well, you've got to have the comedy Ferengi episode, and you've got to have a Mirror Universe episode. It's expected now. So they said, right, fine, we'll get them both done at the same time and just get them all knocked out. You can tell no one's really into this anymore. Worse Regent's an absolute clown. You can tell Kira's really not firing all cylinders in the vampish intendant anymore. Edry's not even particularly keen in her kind of cyberpunk mercenary look, you know, with the heavy eyeshadow. And oh yeah, yeah, it almost gets into carry-on territory at times with the intendant chatting up and seducing everyone, and Edry falling for, you know, basically Edry trying to complete every fanfiction wank fantasy, you know, sort of teenage boy wank fantasy going, and the whole thing just has that kind of carry-on thing, you know. Oh, you know, Lita, we used to be, and I'll get, yeah, that's the other thing, the last Mirror Universe cliche they've not mined. Oh, look, in the Mirror Universe, one of these, in the Evil Universe, one of these characters is gay. Great, brilliant, yeah, that's not a bad message to send. And it's a, ooh, I think you should take me for a debriefing. Yeah, that's my impression of a carry-on film, if you were lost. I've not just lost my mind through the general poorness of this episode. And yeah, this has basically sapped all the momentum and indeed some of the joy out of the series. One thing was, I was briefly on a rant in this episode, and then I actually went back and checked, and I was wrong. So I will give this episode one thing, because I initially remembered the Klingon battlecruiser decloaking in front of Bashir and Kira's runabout in Crossover. But I did go back and check, and it doesn't, it just drives into space. So you could say in the universe, because of the way it works, who knows why, but that cloaking devices never made it to the Klingons. You know, mirror universe, mirror things, for all that everyone's in the same place as bloody always, which is your standard fault with the mirror universe. I think part of the problem with these two episodes is I don't object to them personally. Well, actually, I object to this one a little, but not a huge. I mean, like I say, I don't hate myself for watching it. I didn't find that I wanted to just shout at the people who made it. It was just like, oh, really, are you doing this? This what we're doing? Right, okay, I'm going to be over here in the corner looking at something else. Wait, when it's done. But, you know, neither of these were horribly offensive episodes. It's just that at this point in the series, we had some really good momentum. We've got, you know, the changeling have a disease, and Gul Dukat's on, you know, out there somewhere with the Parwraith doing a plan, and there's weird stuff afoot, and all this stuff. And no, we've got Ezri Dax's family drama, and a Mirror Universe / Ferengi episode. The only thing that we can kind of, you know, thank ourselves for small mercies is that at least they got them both done in the one go. They didn't give us a Mirror Universe episode and a Ferengi episode, but really, I could have done without both these episodes. If you were watching the series on a rewatch and say there was a fault with your DVD or Netflix or something and you couldn't get these two episodes, you would be no worse off, and I think that's the bad part, is at this point in the series, we should be powering towards a goal, rather than kind of stopping to, oh, wait, hang on, Comedy Ferengi episode, so, yeah, I'll still look forward to the next two episodes. Hopefully we'll start gearing up again, or are we going to get some TNG season one, because you've thought we're low now, we might appreciate some season one TNG, just before things get really good. I don't know. So all that remains to say is do keep up the good work. I always enjoy the podcast, and I look forward to the next one. Until then, bye for now.
No, not TNG season one.
Oh, can it really be worse than the pair we've had?
Possibly not than this pair, but I'm hoping things get better. Now, the plan is the remaining season one TNG episodes will be covered, but once we've finished Deep Space Nine, because, yeah, that generally the quality of Deep Space Nine shows them up. Admittedly, yeah, this week we could have easily covered generally no.
And I think what you say is a good point, Parry, where you say that you'd be no worse off if you missed these.
No, definitely not.
There's no B plot.
Absolutely no moving on. Either of these episodes do not move on the plot at all.
Or
they're
even
pointless.
Mention it really. I mean, no. You've had some before where the main plot, you've been like, that's not really worth it. But there's been a mention.
Mm.
There's been something in there, hasn't there? But neither of these episodes had anything.
No. I mean, the problem with the Mirror Universe is there is no Dominion in the Mirror Universe. So immediately you're out of the usual. Which, to begin with was interesting. But as I say, they've exhausted that mine now. There have been Ferengi stories that have interacted with the Dominion in vaguely interesting fashions, but not this one, obviously.
No.
And yes, it's the wrong place to be doing it. The last season, you're throwing out, you're exploring the best things that are left.
Yeah.
Not the bottom of the barrel.
No.
Oh, well.
Oh, and the cloak ships. Yeah, there were cloak ships in crossover. There were in Through the Looking Glass. So we know that the Alliance have cloak ships, thanks to Through the Looking Glass. But apparently, no, they don't by this point. Yeah. Whoop-de-doo. So, do the next two episodes inspire us, bring us hope, enable us to think that things can get better?
Well, I know that there is at least one shit episode that I hate to come. Just because we haven't had it yet.
Okay. So, recording on Friday the 7th of September, bOrgCast 12.7 will be covering Field of Fire.
Now, that makes me think of that good movie. Is that what it's called? No, what's it called? Oh, shit. Maybe it's called that.
Dick of Fire? Probably knowing you?
No! Oh! It came out for the first...
Field of Dreams? Oh, you mean Free Fire?
That's it.
Yes, no, it isn't Free Fire, I'm afraid. It's not building up to those epic lengths, no. It's another Dax episode.
Is it the Dax and Worf one?
It isn't the Dax and Worf one, though. Oh, God, yeah, we got that to come.
That's shit, and I hate it, and it makes you want to kill people.
No, neither of these episodes are that episode. So we still have
a stinker really, to go. Really shit episode.
Honestly can't remember much about Field of Fire beyond the fact that there's a bit of recasting that goes on that irritates me. But beyond that, it might not be bad, I'm not sure. But it is another Dax-centred one, which, you know, really, really, do you want to be doing that at this stage? And then the other one we're covering is Chimera, where another lost changeling turns up, played by somebody slightly familiar. But anyway, you clearly got no memory of that whatsoever. I can't remember if it's any good or not, but unlike the previous two episodes that we covered today, that I remembered neither of them being any good, I don't remember these ones, so hopefully that's a good sign.
I don't know.
We shall see.
Yeah.
Please let them be better. Anyway, Thank you to everybody who's fed back and sat through the tripe that we had this time. Hopefully things will improve next time. We'll catch you then. Cheerio, bye.
I was born in the wagon of a traveling show. My mama used to dance for the money they'd throw. Mama would do whatever he could.
The music at the beginning of this podcast was produced by the 86th Floor on YouTube and is used with their kind permission. All music referenced is for illustrative purposes only and no copyright infringement is intended.
Find our website at bOrgCast.libsyn.com.
And we have a YouTube channel as well.
You can find the bOrgCast playouts on Spotify for your listening pleasure.
Visit our Tumblr site at bOrgCast.tumblr.com, where you'll find images accompanying the episodes discussed in this cast.
Send emails or MP3s to bOrgCast@gmail.com.
Or you can contact us via Twitter on rev_org or bOrgCastAmmo. Hashtag bOrgCast.
Money down.
Shut it down!
Oh! Oh, bollocks!